I'm pulling out of the driveway. We all know what that means. It's time for another Drive to Work Live! Okay, so today's a little bit different. A bunch of R&D people have been having car trouble, so I said I would pick them up. So I'm going to go get Sam Stoddard, I'm going to go get Ben Hayes and Gavin Verhey, all who work in R&D. I borrowed this wide van for them, and we're going to go pick them up. So, and I thought of a great topic for today. Let me start my timer. I thought of a great topic for today, which is a top 10 list. The top 10 myths about R&D. So today I'm going to talk about all the things that people believe to be true that are not true. So we'll start with number 10. Okay. Everybody likes to believe that I'm in charge of R&D. I'm not. I'm actually in charge of design, meaning I'm not even in charge of the designers, there's people that are in charge of that. I'm in charge of actually what the design is. And design goes over a long stretch. So like I'm the beginning of, I'm the beginning part. I do what we call initial design. And then final design is Eric Lauer, which you guys know is probably development. But I'm in charge of the thing. Like, I'm the guy who got Mechanic-E and then 14 years later got it into a set. That's my job. I've been asked many times, do I want to get other, like, Aaron is the head of my boss. And people always ask, and they say, well, do you want Aaron's job? And I'm like, no. I don't want to be the boss of the job I want. I want to be the so I've stuck in this job for a long time because this is what I like to do. But I don't I oversee nobody. I have no reports. I used to at one point. And they finally realized that I'm better at designing than being a manager. So they got something to actually manage. So anyway, I'm pulling up. I think this is Sam's house. Beep, beep, beep. Hey, Sam.
Hey, Mark. Thanks for the ride.
Oh, you're welcome.
It's a nice van.
Yes.
Is it a hybrid?
It is. It runs on red or blue mana. So, Sam, tell the audience a little bit about yourself. I don't know if anyone knows exactly who you are.
My name is Sam Stoddard. I'm a senior game designer. I'm on the development side of Magic, and I write the latest developments column. I've been on a lot of sets, and the two most recent sets I've led are Magic Origins and Eldritch Moon.
Very cool. Okay, so we're talking about the top 10 myths of R&D.
Great subject.
So I just told number 10, everyone thinks I'm in charge. Number 9. All of R&D are designers and developers.
That's certainly what I thought coming into this, but it is a lot different. So we have probably 15 people-ish in the design and development part of the company, mm-hmm. but within R&D there's about 45 people because
40.
Yeah, we have the editors who make sure that people understand what our cards are going to say because most of us are unable to spell or form cohesive sentences, but they fix all that. Then we have the rules team, who of course is in charge of maintaining the rules. We have the digital team who interacts with our digital products to make sure their things get implemented correctly. And of course we have an entire huge number of people devoted to the creative side, both in art and story.
Yes, and I think it's 15 out of 40, so it's a tiny percentage.
Right.
Most people in R&D aren't in design and development.
Most are not. They all get the opportunity to work on card sets. They are not necessarily designing or developing any of the individual cards, though they are giving feedback and playtesting and doing that kind of stuff.
Yeah, one of the days I thought I should post, like I always post the design team. I think it's why people know the designers, the developers, but we need to post like, here's who edited the set. Here's, there's a lot of work that goes into making Magic. And so I think people don't necessarily realize how many different people do. Okay, let's go to myth number 8. So most of the cards we make go into sets.
That would be terrifying. Most of the cards we make are really, really bad. The majority of the time as we're working on sets, we're in a meeting and we're spitballing, and we're like, what if we tried this thing? And often it's like kind of when you're a kid and you're at home and you're like, what would happen if I put tuna fish and sugar and, paprika together and put it on top of cereal? And the answer is not good. But you've learned something, and that's important.
Yeah, I think what a lot of people don't realize, I keep trying to figure out the right percentage. Like, let me ask you this question. What percentage of cards made end up in a set? What's your percentage?
I'm a developer, so a higher percentage of my cards, because
sure.
I just get to put them in the file and protect them jealously, but You know, it's probably below 1%.
Yes, I think it's well below. So what happens is, so let's say you're a designer, you make a bunch of card ideas. You come up with a whole bunch, like I'll sit down, I'll type a whole bunch up, and then I'll go through and I'll edit it. So I don't even turn in all the cards I make. I only turn in the ones I really like of the cards I make, which is a tiny percentage. Then it goes to the lead designer of the set who's doing the set, and they will do some pruning. You know, they'll talk with the team, it gets pruned down. So let's say it gets to the next step, then it goes to playtesting. And then we're iterating and iterating and iterating, so the playtesting like whittles down. And then all along, we keep making other cards, we keep trying to improve the cards. So like if you talk about something that comes at the beginning of design that sees print, it's a tiny, tiny percentage.
And some of that, though, also comes down to how you count what card is a card. So I know one of the cards that we previewed earlier was a 3-dub 2-1 flyer with Fabricate 1. Mm-hmm. And the question is, who designed that card? And you might say, well, early on in design, we had a 3-mana 1-1 flyer, so I designed that card. And someone else might say, well, we were in a meeting, and I suggested moving that to being a 3-2, so I designed that card. And someone else would say, no, I was in a meeting where we suggested this happened. And so a lot of times, you know, there's a lot of convergent ideas, but there's also a lot of, you know, if I'm on a design team and I make a card and it's a 3-mana 2-2, and we take the exact same card and make it a 2-mana 1-1, who made that card? It's more complicated sometimes than exactly that, but the majority of the, if you look at the file as we are in early design and you looked at it at the end, very few of the cards are going to be exactly the same.
Also, another thing that happens, for example, if you asked us who made the dash mechanic from Dragons of Tarkir, so we got an assignment, Sam and I were both on the design team, and we both independently turned in dash without consulting each other, without talking to each other, and like, who made dash? I don't know. We both turned it in. And there's a lot of that. Yeah.
Dave Humphreys also suggested that as the gruel mechanic in Gay Crash. So
yes.
Did he do it? Who knows? You know,
yeah.
Often, you know, we will have an idea for something and Mark will say, oh, we had that in a design file 8 years ago. Nobody else knows that, of course, because everything's in his head. But
well, there's a very funny story where Kelly Diggs, who's now on the creative team, who was an editor for a while and originally was my editor on the website. So he was on a design team and there's a card that made a 1-1, a 2-2, and a 3-3. What's that card?
Bestial Menace.
And so I was writing about it, and I said, oh, I made this card 10 years ago. I guess I've been trying to get it set forever. I guess Ken Nagel, the lead designer, finally put it in. And then I sent it in, and Kelly called me up. He goes, yeah, I made it. And I'm like, oh, okay. Kelly independently had made it, unaware that 10 years earlier I had posted in an article saying, I made this card, but we kicked it out.
Right.
And so Kelly made it, you know, so, but that's how it works. So anyway, I think we're at Ben's house. Beep, beep, beep.
When did you get a van?
I borrowed it.
Thanks for the ride.
So Ben, why don't you fill us with the audience who you are and what you do in R&D?
So I'm Ben Hayes. Like Sam, I'm also a senior game designer in Magic R&D. Like Sam, I also mostly work on the development team. I was for Kaladesh on the initial design team and the development team. I led Commander 2015 and 2016 and the Conspiracy set that just came out, and I led the small set that's going to come after Kaladesh. Been busy lately.
Okay, so let's go. Today we're talking the top 10 myths of R&D.
Okay.
Okay, so number 7, we finish our sets close to their release.
Okay, we don't at all. I stopped working on Conspiracy 2, for example, something like 18 months ago. So now it getting released a few weeks ago, I have to sort of remember what I was like over a year ago. One of the stories that I have about this, it's one of my favorite stories, is in my first few months in R&D, we were working on Born of the Gods, and we were looking at standard decks that were coming out and tournament results. And these red, green, white, really fast attack blitz decks were all over the place with Burning Tree Emissary and Boros Reckoner. And we were like, okay, we really need something in Born of the Gods to beat these decks because they just have all these 2/2s and 3/3s out on like turn 3 and it's just impossible and this deck's going to dominate everything. We're like, okay, we'll come up with Bioblight. Bioblight will be the answer to that deck. So we put Bioblight in Born of the Gods. And then fast forward a really long time, and we have Theros, and we're coming into the Born of the Gods, and we were worried about this white-red-green deck, and the metagame in Theros was very much a mono-blue deck and a mono-black deck, so we were kind of like, I wonder what's going to happen when Bioblight comes out. That's not what we thought was going to happen.
So the story I always tell about this is, we'll put a set out, And then people will see something and they want to give me notes for the next set. Like, you know, a new mechanical come out, like, you know, energy comes out and like, ooh, here's a cool idea for what you could do in Aether Revolt. And it's like, by the time you see it, it's long gone. Like that set is, you know, I'm four sets, you know, way ahead. But people always, because you guys see it for the first time, you get so excited and you want to suggestions, but we have to wait till we go back, I guess, for those.
Right, and similarly, like you are doing your head, what are they called, the head-to-heads?
Yeah.
And a lot of people noted that Nicol Bolas won the most popular villain, and they're like, aha, they used it to figure out who was going to, and it was like, that set's been in, this has been in flight for quite a while, you know, it was a great affirmation. I'm glad he didn't lose in the first round, that would be awkward, but.
He's won twice,
right.
He won both for best Planeswalker and for best villain.
Right, so, you know, that's great, it's a great confirmation, but, you know, things are planned years in advance, so often things, you know, they work out well, there's, you know, great timing and synergy and all these things, but. We do not get to, you know, look at how, you know, Eldritch Moon is doing in Standard and go, okay, we need to fix it. We need a card to fix it.
What's the gap for Standard? How long can you react?
It's about a year. So it's somewhere in the year range for, you know, cards in Standard. So it is not a fast-moving ship. It is very much like, all right, we need to fix this in next year, which, you know, mostly works.
Right,
not
so
always.
To give you guys an idea, so I'm just about to hand off Spaghetti Block, which is the 2019 fall set, and I'm about to begin work on Milk Block, which is the 2018 spring set. Sorry, I'm not the math guy. Okay, let's go on to number six. The number six myth: we play games all day long. Whenever I tell people I work for a game company, they're, oh, it must be fun just playing games all day. So what, is it playing games all day?
So I know that we've argued about whether or not Candyland is a game, but is Excel a game? Because I play a lot of Excel.
Yeah, I mean, there is a lot of playtesting that goes on, but, you know, even a playtest might be anything from we're all getting together in the same room to try to draft, pretending like we're on the Pro Tour and drafting like a lot is at stake and trying to figure out the exact balance, or maybe we're all there to draft with a mechanic none of us have played with before, and afterwards we're just going to talk about what happened with the mechanic. So it's fun, and we are technically playing a game, but I mean, it's always goal-oriented, working on the set, iterating something. And then even that, those playtests are kind of a small percentage of our time. A lot of it's meetings, and like Sam said, a lot of it's Excel spreadsheets.
And even when they're games, a lot of them are not what, like, you know, I have played many games that were not fun games, and both in Magic and otherwise, but many of the games we play at Magic are not fun games, especially early in design. We're like, let's try something out. And again, you try it out, and it's like, yep, that really was not fun. And you can usually tell it's a bad sign if, you know, about half an hour to 45 minutes into a playtest, if everyone's kind of looking to see if they have any taxes they could do, or, you know, looking, maybe I can go visit HR and see if, you know, they have anything to yell at me about, because that would be better than this. That's usually a good sign that we should probably take a look at the mechanics and maybe make something a little more fun.
Yeah, one of my lines is that we play a lot of bad magic, so you don't have to. And also, a lot of times in playtests, by the way, it is not just like a playtest is do whatever you want. What a very common thing in design playtests is I will tell my team, do this. I want you to try this particular thing. Sometimes, for example, we'll do a playtest and I'll say, you're doing white-blue, you're doing blue-black, you're doing red-green. I'll assign people colors because the goal of the playtest is for us to see everything. It's like when you guys play it, you want to have fun. That's what you're supposed to do with it. For us, it is a job and we're trying to figure things out. And a really good playtest, that's another interesting thing. What makes a good playtest? A good playtest is learning something. So sometimes we'll sit down, we'll have a playtest, and we'll go, how was the playtest? And people are like, that was the most unfun experience I've ever had. Here's 20 things that were horrible. Good playtest. So we always are looking out. And like Ben said, I mean, actual playtest, what percentage of time is actual playtesting for you guys?
Maybe between 10 and 20%, depending on, you know, where sets are in the process. But it's a lot of meetings. It's a lot of talking about the set, what we're trying to accomplish. It's a lot of meetings talking about the playtests we just had and what we're going to do based on that feedback.
And there's homework when you do playtests, by the way. Yeah. That when you do playtests, and you have to, I'm bad at doing this, but you have to actually give notes about the playtest so people can see, and we invite people that aren't necessarily on the design team to give playtests. We get a fresh set of eyes, and then you have to give notes so we can look at the notes. There's a lot, it's a lot more to it. I think when you think of it just playing games, I mean, it is games, we're having fun, but it is, there's a lot of work there. It's not just sort of goofing off. Okay, I think we're at Gavin's house. Beep, beep, beep.
Nice van, Mark. What made you pick the color blue?
One of my favorite colors. It's also half red, if you didn't notice.
Yes, of course.
I'm sorry, it's both blue and red? Okay. So number five, so we did our top 10 myths of R&D. So number five, we play test every format.
Yeah, so in Magic R&D, we love every format. We love everything equally, but of course, we only have so much time because, as we mentioned earlier, there's about 15 of us or so actively playing Magic and playtesting Magic, and the majority of players play Standard or Booster Draft, so we like to make sure that those formats are fun and engaging to play, especially because they take a lot of work to get right. And you have to spend a lot of time working on Standard to make sure that the new metagame turns over well. Modern, you can release a new set in two, and a lot of times things will kind of turn out okay. You have to be careful. We make cards for Modern, of course. Sometimes things don't turn out okay. Treasure Cruise. But we, you know, Standard is okay. When a rotation's going to happen, something new is going to come out, we have to make sure it's really balanced and enjoyable to play.
Yeah, I mean, to use Modern as an example, like, because the power level is different between Standard and Modern, it's just a lot easier for us to eyeball a set and figure out the few cards that might impact Modern and then just discuss them as a group. Maybe play a couple games or maybe just sort of brainstorm and try to figure out what the implications are. And then for something like Commander, Commander games take a while, but also we have, as the format's grown and gotten more popular, started playtesting a little bit. We have people in the office who play Commander every Friday, and if we have a card or two we think is gonna be really important for that format, we'll ask those people, like, hey, could you throw this into your deck and then talk to us on Monday?
And some sets more so that than others, right? With Conspiracy, it's not going to hit Standard or Modern, so we actively try and find places for cube cards or commander cards to go in that set, and we can release them, and then we test a lot of those cards individually, too. I know when you're working on Conspiracy 2, which I also worked on, had a great time with, we looked to find a lot of cool commander cards to put into that set.
Yeah, it's definitely true, and for Cube, a lot of us in R&D just have our own cubes, so we can do that pass of looking at the set and asking, you know, would I put this card in my cube? Would I think about putting this card in my cube? And we do that quite a bit.
Limited is also a really good kind of stand-in for a lot of casual formats. One of the things that is very difficult is, it is, you know, when we playtest Standard, we have all the cards. We just kind of put everything together. There are a lot of the people who play our game, especially who are just getting into it, are just not going to have that many cards. Like, we want there to be a good experience if you have all the cards, and so, you know, we want to make sure that Vintage and Commander and Standard and Modern, all those things are really fun and balanced. But we also want to make sure that if you were to buy, like, a Deck Builder's Toolkit and 6 or 7 booster packs, that you can still create decks that are fun and play against other people. If the game was something where it's like, yeah, you really have to buy at least 2 boxes before you can really create a deck, then things wouldn't be very fun and be a very hard game to onboard people into.
And one of the things that happens all the time is I'll get mail where people will bring up formats I've never heard of like, Elf Pauper is really popular in my neck of the woods. What do you guys do to help out Elf Pauper? You know, and we can react as much as we can. There's a priority we have as far as the formats we spend the most time on. Obviously, Limited and Draft is very important. Standard is very important. We spent a little bit of time on Commander, as we talked about, a little bit of time on Modern. But there's a lot of formats to play Magic. There's a lot of formats to play. And so we keep an eye on it, and we try, like, Ben, talk about Tiny Leaders.
Oh, sure. So when I was working on Conspiracy 2, as I mentioned a long time ago, that was sort of right when the internet was starting to talk about Tiny Leaders. People were starting to play that format and check it out.
Tell them what Tiny Leaders is. Some people may not know what Tiny Leaders is.
Oh, sure. Tiny Leaders is a commander-like format where instead of a 100-card deck, you have a 50-card deck. It's sort of like half commander, I guess. It's still a singleton format. But also, every card in your deck, including your commander, has to be 3 or less converted mana cost. Can anyone in the audience confirm that all this is true? Because, okay, great.
What audience, Ben? Who are you talking to?
Hey, people on the street.
So working on Conspiracy 2, there is a blue, black, green, Sultai, 3-color legend in there. That's not an accident. You know, we read everything that gets posted. There wasn't one before, and a set like that can take a few more liberties because it's not going to impact standard. We can do a few more things like just make a card specifically for that format and that audience.
By the way, we're about to pass a school. Whenever I drive by the school, they have a magic club. I like to throw some product to them. So I think we have some magic product. So hey, kids, play magic.
Yeah. Who out there likes Innistrad?
We can't see well, so I apologize.
Throw it into the light.
Oh man, that kid has an Is It shirt on. Nice shirt, kid.
So if you ever see kids chasing my car, now you know why.
It's kind of like the ice cream truck, but even better, because there's magic involved. Speaking of vehicles, am I right?
Okay, so let's go on to the next myth. Number 4. R&D knows all the rules.
Nope.
So in Magic R&D, I'd say some of us know the rules more than others. Some of us were judges at previous points in time. But regardless, at least 10 to 20 times every set, that's probably a very small number, we'll go over to Matt Tabak and Eli Schifrin, who also works on the rules, and be like, so let me tell you about this mechanic that probably won't work. And a lot of the time, they'll say, yeah, that definitely doesn't work. Sometimes they'll be like, we can make that work, but it'll require rewriting half the rules. And other times they'll tell us, it works. But we necessarily don't all have a great grasp of exactly how the rules work. We know how to play Magic. We know the intricacies. But when you have to come up with something new, sometimes you have to pull on the strings of Magic that you wouldn't normally be pulling on.
Yeah, I mean, the number of times I've been playing a game where I have a creature and then its base power and toughness gets set to 1, but it has 2+1/+1 counters on it, and has an aura on it that gives it flying and an aura on it that gives it -2/-0 and loses flying. And I'm like, hey, Matt, help.
My favorite set to try and avoid is the Layers Matter set.
Yeah, people occasionally ask, like, could we have a set where base power matters? I'm like, you don't know what you're asking.
One of my favorite stories is I was in one of my columns, I talked about how we had changed a card in Dragons of Tarkir. It used to give the creature -6/-0, and then we realized that that was very bad with Ferocious. And so I mentioned that we changed it to make it in a 0/2 instead, and someone angrily said, you know, it's just, you know, why? How is anyone confused by this? And I was like, well, you know, they got confused because instead of needing, 8 power, you needed like 12, all of a sudden, all of a sudden you needed, you know, an additional 6 power because that you were at -6. And they said, oh, I didn't realize that's how that worked. And it's like, I know.
One of Magic's biggest barriers to entry, and Mark talks about this a lot, is the complexity, right? There's a lot going on in Magic. It can be a very complicated game. And if we're having trouble figuring out what's happening in a game and we play Magic all day, you know, more or less.
That's the myth. We don't play Magic.
Well, he wasn't enough. Here. He didn't know.
Right. What myth are you talking
catching
about?
Catching you up. Sorry.
I thought we just had 5 myths. But if we don't know, then how are all of our players expected to know, right?
We also have the big advantage that we get to change the rules, which is both a curse and a great bonus. So when, for instance, when we're working on Bestow, we changed some of the way that, you know, enchantments work to make it so that, you know, when you cast a Bestow creature, if you killed the creature in response, you still got the creature on the Bestow creature on the battlefield. And I remember we kind of had at that point some external people who were judges who would look at cards and they would say, well, this mechanic doesn't really work, but, and it's like, well, do you have to think that we are going to make the mechanics actually work? Like, we're not going to print something that doesn't actually work. Though I will mention that, Meld from EMN? It took quite a toll on us. I think we lost 1 rules manager, 1 editor, and at least, like, I don't know, 1 person from digital over that one. Sorry. But it was worth it because you got to play with cards like this.
Plus, we got to do all that team building afterwards.
Right. You know, we got time with the the safe space and the blankets. And
so here's my story, which will explain why something in Magic changed forever. So the very first Invitational was held back when it's called the Duelist Invitational was held in Hong Kong, and originally we were going to hold the event. I did a whole podcast on this. We were going to hold the event, I think, in San Diego, and then this event fell through. The first early Grand Prix was going to be in Hong Kong, but the Grand Prix weren't ready yet. So they came to me and said, are you willing to have your event in Hong Kong instead of San Diego? I was like, of course I am. Let's go to Hong Kong. So we decided, I was trying to do weird formats, and so we were like, we wanted to show off something that was coming up, and Visions was about to come out. So I convinced them to let me do Standard, but with Visions before Visions was legal. Sounds like an awesome idea. And then Tomas Anderson from Sweden, I believe, discovered that Sands of Time, if you turn it off by tapping it, does all sorts of crazy things. And he made the earliest version of the Sands of Poise deck. Caused all sorts of chaos in the tournament. And I went back furious talking to Bill Rose saying, why do artifacts shut off? We keep making this mistake. Could we just get rid of that stupid rule? And that's why the rule got rid of in 6th edition. So Thomas Anderson's responsible for artifacts not turning off anymore. So okay, let's go on to the next myth. Myth number 3, developers only tweak numbers of cards. So some developers, why don't you talk about this?
That's just true. I've read your Tumblr. It's pretty obvious.
Yep.
No, developers do a lot more than that. We, one of the things, the way I like to describe it is design kind of hands over the novel and development kind of makes the movie. So, you know, there are a lot of things that are going to work better in the novel and there are a lot of things that are going to work better in the movie, but you can clearly, you know, tell what the same, it's the same set, but a lot of things are going to change. And so the developers will, you know, the most common changes, of course, cards for limited. The designers play kind of a different, they play limited, but the power level tends to be a lot more flat. They don't spend a ton of time trying to figure out, okay, each color needs to be perfectly balanced, or here's the cards we want to be the strongest, here's the cards we want to be the weakest. They think, okay, let's just see if we can get the set mechanics to work, and they try to do things more flat. And developers come in, they're like, okay, we need, for instance, blue needs the strongest flyer, and okay, why is the strongest removal spell in green? It's not really the removal color. The strongest removal spell should be in black or red. So we make a card stronger, we make a card weaker. And so, you know, we do change a ton of cards for that. Then we come to Standard, and it's like, okay, well, we need Hallowed Moonlight. Like, that's just not a card that design is going to hand over ever. So we have to make up that card, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, I mean, we definitely do a lot of balancing. And we do change a lot of numbers, but the way that I think of it is that, I mean, it's always with the goal of making the set the most fun it can be for as many people as possible. We're not just sitting around all day trying to figure out how to make Standard the most balanced it can be, or Limited the most perfectly balanced it can be. Those are important, but, I mean, the end goal is fun, and trying to make sure that whatever the vision is that comes through in the design is something that's accessible for all different types of players, all different levels of players in a bunch of different types of formats. So it's just taking that and trying to bring it to life as much and in as many different ways as we can. And a lot of that comes through changing the numbers or designing things to be put together in a certain way, but it's not all that.
Right, a good example is how often design sets are very much within a biome. It's, we are making a set that is only played with a set. That's just how design sets work. And so when Theros was handed over, the removal was in the position where it was all, okay, so, you know, so here's the problem. Auras are really weak, so we need to figure out how to make auras stronger. Let's make the removal bad, which works, but it doesn't, it's not very satisfying if all of a sudden, like, Mark of the Vampire is the strongest card because there's no way to kill a creature with it on it. But it's also like, well, you can't go to your, local, pre-PTQ and say, okay, just so we're clear, we're playing no counter spells, no land destruction, no creature removal, right? You know, we have to make sets that are going to work with people, the rest of people's collection, the rest of cards in Magic. And so, you know, design had handed over this set, and there was a lot of ideas of, we want auras to be important, we want enchantments to matter, we want heroic to be this build-up mechanic. And so it was on development to take that idea and figure out how to adjust the set in such a way to make it work with the wider thing. And that's where some of the tweaks happened to bestow, to make, you know, to up the amount of bestow, really get it in the set and up the amount, and make sure that, you know, if you killed the creature in response, you still got the thing, to add a secondary cost to bestow, so there were more knobs there. Plus, we just have to make up a ton of cards, because, you know, the removal in the set was all very weak, so we have to come up with stronger removal. We need to make it so that there are more things to do in limited. So a ton of the cards that are handed over from design do end up getting killed or getting, you know, changed to a point that you wouldn't really recognize them. Well, but we're trying to keep the vision and keep all the ideas and make this set the fun version of what they were playing with, like not just the version they're playing with, which is fun, but the version that they're playing with, which is fun and interacts with the rest of Magic.
Here's an important thing that people don't tend to realize is two things. One is, imagine sort of a ramp, for example, that design's the first part and development's the second part, but it's not like it's a major change. It's just like it's the first part of the system, and at some point we hand over. The difference between the end of design and the beginning of development is really, really similar. Now, given design tends to specialize in the take the blank page and have nothing and make something, and development tends to have the ability to fine-tune within environments, but all the skills that you need, a lot of the thing is, developers have a lot of the design skills, just a little lower down than some of the designers do, and designers have some of the development skills, but much lower down than developers do, and it is not, like, our jobs are not that different. They really are a lot more similar than people think. You know, it's all of our jobs to make it a fun game. It's all of our jobs to make sure the audience enjoys what we're doing. And there's different focuses and there's different things we look at. And I know, like, on my end of the spectrum, you know, I'm looking a lot more at big picture stuff. Like, the way I like to think of it is, you start from like a 10,000 aerial view and you're trying to figure out what it looks like. And as you get closer to the ground, you start caring about details that just don't matter when you're way high up. And a lot of times when I start with mechanics, we're just trying to figure out things that we think are interesting and fun. But then it's a matter of making them actually work. And a lot of the great stories, you know, is, okay, here's a neat idea, it's fun, but, and for example, let's take something like vehicles. When we came up with vehicles, we had an idea in mind. We knew that we wanted something that was a top-down vehicle. And we really early on said, okay, well, you have to drive it. Like, what makes it a vehicle? Well, there's a driver. Like, somehow a vehicle just doesn't attack by itself. And that was our vision, like, okay, somehow the driver drives the vehicle. And it went through, iteration after iteration after iteration. And even once we got kind of the area we wanted, just the number of different kinds of things within that we had to try, you know, and that is kind of the sort of, as we make design things, is watching the slow evolution. And that we care about the big thing, we solve that, then we care about the next biggest thing. And we keep going down till we get to the minutia, the fine work stuff.
Right, that happened a lot with energy as well, where Eric Lauer, who was the developer lead for the beginning of that set, when we started playing with the developers, we were kind of unsatisfied with energy because we're like, well, it's pretty obvious this card just is stronger, so I play this card that gives me energy, but I never use it on it. But so he went and watched the designers play, and the designers were more like, oh, I don't know, maybe I'll try this and maybe I'll try that. And they were having a lot of fun with it, because they weren't being like hypercritical or trying to play at a really high level and just very cutthroat and win. They were just kind of like, oh, let's try some new stuff out. And so the way that they had set up energy worked really well for that. But when you put it to people that were trying to win competitively, all of a sudden it broke down, because it was like, well, you just find the most powerful energy outlet and you just put all your energy through that. And so what he did was figure out, okay, we need to kind of develop an energy economy and make it so that everything's flat. So, you know, we both need to make cards where you have interesting decisions, but also that there'll be no one card where it's the most efficient card for spending energy, because that's the one you spend it all on. We have to actually make, I think we tweaked some of the actual rates that you got energy at, so that we could be more granular and say, okay, this card gives you 3, but it costs 2 to use. This card gives you 3, costs 1 to use. This one gives you 1 and costs 4 to use, and all these things like that. So we could actually come up with useful things where, it wasn't clear for the developers which one, you know, which way you're supposed to use the energy. And so if it's not clear for us, and then the designers are still having fun with it, we've kind of hit the right spot.
Yeah, two things. One, Eric's big thing on energy was figuring, he actually doubled the amount of energy so he could get more granular with it. that was one of the problems was we had turned it over, so it was just, it was too big a cost for one.
Right.
And he just said, oh, let's just double it. Then I can give you one energy, which is half the effect.
Right.
The other thing that happens all the time, by the way, which is funny, Sam, talking about this, is design will make something, and it's really fun, and we have a lot of fun with it, and then we give it to developers, and they're like, well, if it just plays optimally, it's not fun. And I'm like, oh.
Why must people try and win games of Magic?
Yeah. In a lot of, to use Mark's example of vehicles, a lot of vehicles was trying to figure out, there's so many different choices we have for how to implement this mechanic, what's important about the mechanic. And I think the most important thing about vehicles is that creatures interact with them, creatures drive them, or let you use them. And then whether we're using mana to turn it into a creature and let it attack, in addition to that, or tapping the creatures, or whether the vehicles have haste or not, or whether they're creatures all the time or not creatures all the time, you know, you sort of start creating this stack rank of how important each aspect of it is. And in the end, we were never going to make a vehicle mechanic that didn't use creatures, but we did end up making one where you don't need to pay mana to turn the vehicle into a creature. It is just all the creature. And so going through that process and then weighing, like, what's the most fun versus how much we gain or lose from making any of those decisions.
Right, the earliest version of vehicles, or I shouldn't say earliest, an early version. The earliest, I'm sure, was just utterly ludicrous.
It was.
Back in the Stone Age.
Right, yeah. But the kind of the version that was handed over was tap so many number of creatures, which, you know, had the problem being less granular because it's like, well, 2/1/1s is just way better than 1/2/2 in this world. And the size of the vehicles was very different because the designers are more likely to buy in and try the cool new things. So they're like, I'm playing my 4-mana 3/3 vehicle. And they're like, developers, how big does a 4-mana vehicle need to be? And you're like, with we have to tap 3 creatures. And you're like, I don't know, like 8/8. And, you know, and it's like, would you play it at 8/8? They're like, I'll think about it. And so that's that spot of like, well, we need to actually be able to make this mechanic in a way where the people who want to buy into it and that are super excited by it, they're going to have fun and put it in their decks. But at the same time, it's not just a huge trap. And so, you know, we could make that mechanic, and the people who really want to put a, you know, juggernaut driving a boat, driving a plane, driving a taxi cab, like, they can totally do that, but we want that to be something that can actually be strong and powerful for constructed and stuff. So we had to tweak the mechanic quite a bit and tweak the cards quite a bit to find the right numbers to where, okay, it's fun and constructed, it's fun and limited, and the people who want to do the super goofy stuff, they, you know, not only can they still do it, but it might actually be good now.
So there's a quality of a mechanic that we talk a lot about internally called knobbiness. And what that means is how many different knobs are there that you can play with, because the knobbier it is, the easier it is for development to be able to tune it. Like, for example, if there's just one number, and that one number, you know, that's all you have, wow, it's hard to sort of get any granularity to it. It's very hard to do. But if there's like 3 different numbers, like vehicles had a lot of knobbiness to it. There was a lot of different things you could play around with. You know, there was the power and the toughness and what it cost to get it and, you know, the cost. And there are a lot of things you can play around with where, like Fabricate, I know when we first introduced Fabricate, the concern was Fabricate N has to be these 2 things. They must be the same. Okay, develop that. And there was a lot of worry early on.
Yeah, right. Fabricate was a tough one. I mean, because of the sort of creature curve of what power and toughness we give you at different mana costs, the number of different Fabricate designs there are isn't huge unless you start adding keywords and you start adding extra abilities where you can use the servo for something else. Or maybe you have an ability where you care about the creature's power, so you're more interested in putting the +1/+1 counters on. So in the beginning, when we were first talking about Fabricate on the design team, I was pretty nervous because I was like, okay, I've made 5 Fabricate cards. I don't know if I can make a 6th one. We might be in trouble. But then, you know, as we explored more and tried more things out and got more people involved, we were able to make a wider variety of them.
Right, that happens a lot in design, and it happens in development too, where you're like, you have a great idea, you know, it could be a cycle, it could be a mechanic, and one of my favorite examples was Negative Bestow in Journey into Nyx, where the original idea was the cards didn't grant power and toughness to your opponent's creature, they just like gave them the negative ability, and then once that other creature died, you would get your thing. So, for instance, there was it ended up being the Hound that forced your opponent's creature to attack, and this was the thing that sold it on. It was, okay, so it's this enchantment that you put on your opponent's creature. It has to attack. It doesn't get any bigger. You block it. You have a 2/2. It's like, okay, great. What's the next one? It's like, there's a green one and it has to block. Okay, what's the next one? There's a white pacifism and it's like, it's never going to die. And they're like, okay, let's try another one. Black. And it's like, I guess it can't block. And it's like, oh, now it's also never going to die. and that will happen where, you know, you have a great idea, you kind of don't kick the tires enough, and then you get along and you're like, oh yeah, that actually, there's like 6 total cards we can make. Do we need to make 7 cards? Because we can make 6. Yeah, Sometimes 6 is enough.
I've said quite a few times that a lot of my favorite cards were mechanics ones. Just like you find that there's a couple of really good designs, and you pick the one that you really like, and it ends up as a card, and
right.
not a mechanic that goes on lots of cards.
Like when we were working on Fabricate, when it made Thopters, that was another example where the developers were saying, well, you just choose Thopters every time, and sometimes the designers would say, well, but sometimes I choose this one, and you know, we have to go, no, you're wrong, which doesn't always go over well, and makes people unhappy, and that's not great. But,
thanks, Sam.
Yeah, but you know, it's like, well, I can make a 3/3, or I can have a 1/1 and 2 flyers, and it's like, well, you get the 1/1 and 2 flyers. Well, what if I want the 3/3? Well, you'd be wrong. I don't know how to tell you. I don't know how to help you on this.
Back to trust falls.
Yeah, then it's trust falls and.
Yeah, one of the things that's always, when you're designing things, there's different things that can kill things along the way. Like at some point, you got to go talk to the rules manager and like, okay, do rules actually work for this? You have to talk to templating, like, can this actually be templated? You know, you talk to development, like, can this be developed? And so there's a lot of pitfalls along the way. So a lot of times we make a lot of mechanics you never see because it hits one of the things along the way and it just never makes it.
And part of good design, too, is trying to set yourself up for success where you can. When you're working on design, like me and Mark often are, before we hand off to development, like Sam and Ben, making mechanics that will have a higher chance of being successful, as in higher chance of going through templating successfully, higher chance of having enough numbers to be developed successfully, just means that your mechanic has a greater chance of succeeding and probably a greater chance of being understood by the wider Magic playing populace.
Okay, let's go on to myth number 2. Number 2, only people in R&D make Magic.
That's not true. So inside Wizards of the Coast, Magic R&D, obviously, we're the ones who work on Magic design and development the most, but actually a lot of people inside Wizards have a chance to work. Every single person inside the company has a chance to make a card, so if you ever want to come work for Wizards of the Coast, you too can have a chance. Check our jobs website for more information. But you get the opportunity to do things like rare polls, where we send out rares to people in the company, and they get to vote them on a scale of 1 to 10, how much they like them, leave comments about them. We use all that information to help make our sets. There's hole filling that goes out throughout the company, where we will remove rares from sets, and then say, okay, we've got 10 open holes, we need another red rare enchantment, what's it gonna do this time? And then we send it out to everybody, and people have a chance to make that. Additionally, there's play tests that are open. We have a monthly play test where anybody can come and play. All kinds of opportunities to play and create Magic inside Wizards of the Coast, even without having to work inside Magic R&D.
And even earlier than that, one of the things that we do is, what is the
First Friday?
No, when we are first kind of brainstorming ideas, so, you know, like for instance, we were going to do Kaladesh and go to Artifact World, we had kind of a make-your-own-set thing where a lot of people in the company...
Boo drafts,
right. Yeah. Build your own draft, basically. And so people have the opportunity to be like, okay, imagine that you are making a set that was an artifact set and, you know, kind of give the parameters.
Like a steampunk set.
Steampunk set, yeah. Make up cards. And people will make up huge number of cards. And, you know, they have they work with each other to kind of balance things. And a lot of the designers will end up interacting with them and playing in these drafts. And oftentimes they're just totally ludicrous things that we would not end up doing. But we learn a lot. And, you know, one of the things that we will often learn from them, like, that is part of where, you know, vehicles, so many people are doing different designs for vehicles. It gave us a lot of help in terms of finding out a couple things. One is, okay, we've determined people really like the idea of vehicles. There are these certain things that they're hitting a lot, so these are probably the kind of expectations we should be meeting. And here might be some really good designs or some really good ideas for the mechanic. Let's figure out how to make, like, take these really good ideas that other people in the company have come up with and actually start importing them into the exploratory design process.
So let me talk about boot drafts real quick, because there's something you guys can actually do at home. It's kind of fun. So what we do is we give them a theme. For our purposes, we'll give them themes of stuff that are up and coming. So we'll say, hey, we're making a steampunk set. What would you make for a steampunk set? So then everybody designs, how many cards do they design?
45.
42 cards 42. Now, actually.
42 cards. Then they get submitted, and a bunch of R&D folk will give a pass to make sure they're not broken.
Yeah, we have a council of development that looks at all of the Boo Draft cards and helps balance them to make sure that the draft goes at least reasonably. And another thing we do, because I don't know if you know this, Mark, necessarily, is we add in some core set cards as well to help make sure that, oh, there's a Windrake in here or a Shatter in here, stuff like that.
And then they get together in groups of eight? How does the draft work?
We divide it evenly. If there's, 24 participants, we'll divide it into three pods of eight and so on.
Yeah, and then they actually play. So they'll actually play with the cards, and then we get notes on sort of what's fun. So they play with the cards, they give notes on what they liked and didn't like. And then we will look at all the cards that get made, and we'll look at all the notes they have. And for example, the reason the Boo Draft is really valuable for us is, number one is, what do people expect? It's very telling. Like, when we said we're doing Steampunk World, like, five people made vehicles, and we're like, okay, people seem to think that Steampunk World will have vehicles. That was really telling to us. And it's also, like, just sometimes people come up with interesting ideas. Like, that's one of the things about this myth is, if you have a good idea, we will take good ideas. We don't care where the idea comes from. If someone gives us a good mechanic through a Boo Draft or a hole filling or whatever, we'll use it and we'll put it in. And that's everybody who works at Wizards is there to help us contribute to Magic.
And also something worth noting is, in addition to mining trope space, like Mark said, oh, there's a lot of vehicles, people want vehicles, it also just gives us a ton of cards to look at, and occasionally cards will come out of there. If you guys know the card Humble Defector from Fate Reforged, Dan Helland, who's actually the coordinator, the guy that stickers all of our playtest cards, just put that into a Boo Draft file one day, Ken Nagel saw it, loved it, put it in a set, and it made it all the way to print. So there's a lot of ways to get your cards into actual Magic sets.
Right, similarly, the card Eldritch Evolution from EMN was submitted through hole filling by Ryan Prince, who works in our Magic Online department. He did the hole filling, had a cool idea for a card, we tweaked it a bit, and all of a sudden, 2 years later, it's in print.
The other great thing is we keep all this stuff around forever, so maybe you submit a card for hole filling and it doesn't make it into the set. I just leave it on my desk. 6 months later, I'm like, I need a green creature again for a rare. What are the odds? Well, let me look through all these old hole filling results, and maybe there's a cool card in there somewhere I can use for this.
Yeah, or sometimes multiple sets will be in the works at the same time, and one set will send a bunch of people out, get a bunch of cards, and then they'll be, I have a lot of cool cards here, I can't use them all. Hey, I know you're working on a set too, here's a bunch of cards, do any of them work in your set?
Also, by the way, people who work at Wizards that don't have much magic knowledge are also very valuable to us. And here's why. We want to know what people think of things, and the problem is we've seen it, and plus R&D is not your average magic player, so what we do is we do a lot of testing. So let's say, for example, I know we did this with vehicles and with energy. Like, okay, we want to make an energy symbol. We want to make sure people read it and understand it. Let's actually make different versions of it, and then we'll go around the company to people that aren't, super well-versed in magic to say, hey, okay, what do you think of this?
Right, one weird quirk about working at Wizards of the Coast is it's really hard to get people who have never played magic before to tell you what they think about the stuff that you make. Where, if I was in the real world, I could just walk around on the street and be like, hey, what do you think about how cool this looks? Inside Wizards, that's a very limited resource. So we'll often mock up new mechanics and things like that and show them around the office to people who have just been hired or people who don't have as much magic experience to try and get their opinions on how this frame looks or how this mechanic looks at them. Does that read exciting? Is this world concept really cool? Those are all things that once you've been in the building for too long, once you've worked on magic cards for too long, you gain other abilities. You become a more tuned magic player, but you don't quite have that same initial first look that a lot of people do. In fact, when we bring somebody in the office right away, when we bring in a new hire into Magic R&D, one of the first things Mark has them do is look through all the stuff that we've made and be like, okay, what's your initial opinion on all this stuff? What do you think about it?
This happened with BFZ when we had to do the Devoid frames, and Liz Leo, who is awesome, made the frames, and because we had this amazing challenge of, okay, so we need these cards, and they're supposed to look like they're colored cards in your hand, but on the battlefield they look colorless. Go. This was not an easy task, very hard, and so she came up with a bunch of awesome designs. Okay, well, what if we did this? What if we did this? We tried it where they just had the mana cost, and everything else was a complete colorless frame. We had all these ones that there's varying levels of this, and so we'd go to people, and within R&D, we would argue about things, and I like this one, I like this one, I like this one. But it's very, once we've kind of, picked our horses in the race and really tried to, really decided I like this one, it's really hard for us to figure out whether or not something is better or worse because we've very, you know, we have our own opinion, so we have to go to the people and say, okay, here's a card. Tell me about it. And if they look at, you know, a blue devoid card and they're like, I don't understand this, or they're just like, what color is it? And they're like, I don't think it is a color. We have a problem. If we, you know, so what we had to do was really take these things, you know, within R&D, figure out what the best ideas were, but then take them around the company and get opinions from people who, you know, have not seen these yet. And so, you know, get an idea of what people are going to think. We don't want to get super, you know, inbred in our thinking, and then we release it to the public, and no one has any idea what it is, because we've confused or we've lied to ourselves and been like, well, we've been looking at it for 8 months. Obviously, we know what it is. You know, first impressions are really important, and getting that from people earnestly within the company is also really, really important.
I know Mark has received a lot of constructive feedback on the devoid mechanic. And but you know, we tested it as just a color indicator originally without the words devoid on the card at all through playing with people in the building, and they just didn't understand what it was, which is why we ultimately went to having a keyword mechanic be there, because it was so important for people to understand how it worked. And that's the kind of thing that we can argue about all we want inside where Magic R&D sits, but until people actually do it who don't know Magic as well and experience it, we're not really going to know how people in the real world are going to react to it.
Okay, and finally, we get to the final myth about R&D. Number one, R&D can change the cards at any time.
Well, after this, I'll go and just Sharpie in the top right-hand corner of some cards and fix their mana cost mark in Kaladesh. Is that cool?
Yeah, one of the things I think people think about is R&D has a decent amount of control, but as the progress goes along, there's a lot that goes to make a Magic card. And what happens is, the farther along you get, the more things are cemented in. So for example, once the art has been commissioned, that's the art on the card. Mm-hmm. So like you can change the card somewhat, but it has to still match the art. And so like a lot of designs are, okay, look at this piece of art. Okay, here's what we want. Can you design something in that parameters that matches the art?
Right, there's a certain amount of bargaining that goes in whenever you have a card and you're like, okay, this card's not working. And you look at the art and you're like, you know, you're like, well, we need a flying creature. You look at the art, you go. You go to the art directors, you're like, this can fly, right? And they're like, what, are you kidding me? Of course this is. He's like wearing an 80-pound, you know, plate mail with a sword, and he's like, you know, carrying two horses. And you're like, well, but that means he's really strong, so he didn't have the, you know. So you're like, okay, well, you know, there's some amount of bargaining for that with the art. But, you know, ultimately, you know, once the art's in, you know, we have a certain amount of budget for cards where we can say, you know what, we messed up. We need a card in standard that does this. There's nothing in the set that has that art. We just have to commission new art. There's some amount of budget for that, but we can only get so many arts done at a time. If we had to, you know, go back to a set and say, okay, let's recommission 40 cards in the set, well, the next set in the line, they don't get to have 40 less cards. They don't get to just take all those arts and be like, let's repurpose them all. Like, you know, core set's got to do that. We don't get to do that anymore. You're not going to see a whole bunch of, like, Eldrazi on Kaladesh because we just, you know, we're like, well, we have too many Eldrazi in this set, move them to the next one. We don't get to do that. At some point, there is a pencils down point, and, you know, we get to make small tweaks here or there. We get to make a few emergency things, but, you know, trust me, if Collect a Company could be a sorcery right now, Collect a Company would be a sorcery right now. We just don't get to make that, you know, after the set has gone to print, there's just nothing you can do.
So we kind of have two art waves, we call them, inside Magic R&D, and the first art wave is about half the set. And second art wave is the rest of the set. So there's a few tricks you pick up as you go along. For example, if you commission a flying creature in the first art wave, and then you need to be a non-flying creature for the second art wave, maybe one of your other creatures trades art with it or something like that, right? So then you can commission a non-flying piece of artwork for the second time around. But once you've commissioned all of the art, it can get really, really hard to switch things around, and that can often pin us into corners. So we have to figure out how to solve problems in a limited space, but of course, as Mark always says, restriction breeds creativity, so we try and do the best job we can.
Yeah, one of the things about the art waves is trying to figure out what things you most likely don't need to change the art. So obviously, basic lands always go in the first art wave. A lot of times, legends will go in early art wave because even though the creature might change, look, it's a picture of the person. It's going to be the picture of the person. And so, you know, there's certain tricks you learn about what to put early and what to put late. And things that you're less sure of, like one of the ways to tell what development's least sure of is what mechanic isn't in the first wave.
Right, Chandra throwing fire at something, first wave, we're good. the dragon that's flying and breathing fire, like, yeah, that's probably gets to do a lot of things. You know, a big problem often is, you know, Magic has certain rules for how big creatures can be. So, you know, they're not always super hard and fast, but for instance, you know, we don't want to have a 1-1 dragon. We don't want to have a, you know, 1-1 minotaur was a rule that we basically couldn't have. And so it was like, okay, well, we need to, you know, commission those a little larger. At the same time, we can't have a regular human being a 5-5. You got to, if you have a 5-5, you need to be a human. It's either a large group of humans or it could be a legend, because legends get to just be super awesome and have the biggest sword and, you know, do all that stuff. So, yeah, sure, legend can be a 5-5.
But there's limits. So in Odyssey, in Theros, I wanted to make a Hercules card based on Hercules. So originally, I think it was a 12-12, and the creative team said, a human can't be a 12. I go, it's Hercules! And they're like, I'm like, 11-11 or 10-10? You know, like we're trying to draw the line between, like, supernatural human, how can it be? And that's another big thing, by the way, we didn't talk too much about, is working with the creative team, we talked a lot about rules and editing. Like, a lot of times, like vehicles, for example, here's a good example. We were trying to figure out whether or not vehicles were always creatures and you couldn't attack or block with them, or whether they turned into creatures. And the creative team came back to us and said, they're not creatures all the time. Like, they really said, we don't mind you turning them into creatures to drive them, but could you make them not always creatures? That doesn't make any sense. And so the reason we chose that path was the creative. And with that, often we always go and talk to the creative team about what makes the right choice. Like, what is the thing that's going to drive it? To make sure, drive it. But we always want to make sure that it makes flavor sense. And so that's another, like, there's so many different factors we have to care about. That when we talk about, you know, you can change a card at any time, no, you can't, because as you evolve, there's lots of things you care about. Have I told the story about spirit links? Have I told the spirit link story? I think I have. The short version is, there was a card, a spectral links in, what card was spectral links in?
Apocalypse.
Was called spirit links in late development. And I was in charge of the naming at the time. And I go, but it doesn't have, you know, life link, basically. And at the time, that people referred to it as the spirit link ability. Well, like, spirit links can't not have spirit link. But it was so late in the process that the collector numbers were locked. So I had from, like, SPA to SPI to get a word. And that's how it ended up becoming spectral links.
One of the things to me that makes Magic one of the greatest games in the world is that all these teams work so closely together. Creative and design and development and brand and all these teams in Wizards of the Coast working together to make the best possible game. And on our development and design teams, we embed people from other teams in there. It's not just all designers or all developers. Design teams have a development member. They always have a creative member. Sometimes they'll even have a rules team member or a brand member on them, just to help make sure that all the different aspects of Magic are firing on all cylinders as often as possible.
We often get into big fights over things because everyone believes their thing is the most important and everything's got to bow to their thing, and I'm guilty of it, we're all guilty of it, being like, no, this is the most important thing, and some of that's bad, but some of it's really good, because, you know, nobody's like backing down to everyone else and saying, yeah, whatever, we'll just say that guy flies, who cares. Like, the fact that everyone cares super about everything they're doing, their passion, means that we end up at, you know, even though it's sometimes harder to make things, at the end we have a much better product.
Okay, so can you take the wheel, Sam?
Sure.
I was carrying something to work I thought we'd talk about before we got to work, which is, we have a vehicle, a car nonetheless, because it seemed apropos. So I'd like to introduce the world to Fleet Wheel Cruiser. So Ben, do you remember anything about the making of this car?
Is it the trample haste? Yeah. About the making of this card, I knew we wanted, pretty early on, we were interested in the idea of a vehicle that got that first sort of crew for free. It also let us have a higher crew number. As the crew number goes up, it's harder and harder to turn the vehicle into a creature. And so we were sort of happy with that pairing of a slightly higher number there with you getting the first shot for free.
Yeah, remember we argued a little bit with creative, because they're like, so who's driving the car?
Speaking of working together, the self-driving car was a little bit of a hard sell.
You the planeswalker driving the car, you cast it, it's on for the turn.
You learn what treats people like, what, you know, what to bring them to get them in the best mood, those kind of things.
Yeah. So anyway, I see work up ahead, so we got to pull in here. So I want to, before we end, thank all my carpool guests for joining me. I don't often get to drive a van, so that was fun. So anyway, I'm pulling in the parking space, so we all know what that means. It means it's the end of my drive to work. So instead of talking magic, it's time for all of us to be making magic. Thank you guys very much.